Unfortunately for our mad science dreams of doing a Jurassic Park, preserving DNA in amber can't quite make it for tens of millions of years. But can we do a better job ourselves? Can our polymers contain science? Our biology uses DNA to store genetic information, and DNA is a pretty groovy molecule to do so. As complex molecules go, it's super stable. DNA from incredibly long ago, like the Cretaceous, may have degraded, but we've successfully extracted DNA samples from 2 million-year-old specimens, which is an incredibly long shelf life. It's also a dense storage medium. 2 nucleotides can encode 1 bit of information and take up only a cubic nanometer of space. That's not the literally densest storage ever created, but as one MIT bioengineer pointed out, we could theoretically store all the world's data in a single coffee mug full of DNA, which puts even my impressive little network-attached storage to shame. So, for years, scientists have explored DNA as a data storage medium, especially for archival storage. After all, our bodies use DNA to encode information about protein synthesis, but we have the technology to synthesize DNA ourselves, so there's nothing stopping us from using nucleotides to represent zeros and ones to encode data like text files, photos, whatever we want. And because scientists are absolute dorks, they've leveraged that trick for years to do things like write a marriage proposal in DNA for their partner to sequence. For DNA to become a practical means of storing data, though, rather than a one-off gimmick, albeit an adorable one, 2 things need to happen. One is that the cost of DNA synthesis would have to come down, like 6 orders of magnitude, in order to become comparable with cost of magnetic tape, the current gold standard in long-term archival storage. But if I'm really going to cold store past episodes of May Contain Science and sequences of A, C, T, and G, I'm also going to need a way to store the DNA itself, one that will let me easily access the information without damaging it when I do need to learn about poison dart frogs. And these days, that storage is a bit of a pain. See, DNA is stable as complex molecules go, but it does still degrade somewhat if it's just out on the kitchen counter, exposed to ambient moisture and so on, and that degradation would totally mess up the visual quality of how cute those frogs are if I try to use DNA to store video on it in those conditions. The lab standard for storing DNA is freezing, which is more cooling than even the fanciest storage servers require. So, we gotta find some energy and space-efficient way of storing the DNA. Perhaps encasing it, somehow. Yeah, you see where I'm going with this. Previous research has stored DNA in silica. I don't mean in silica like on a computer, I mean like a little 6-micrometer particle of silica, which is like less than a tenth the size of a fine grain of sand, which, hey, very impressive, very small, but size is hardly the only factor in data storage. It took days to get the DNA into the silica for storage, and it took hydrofluoric acid to get the DNA back out when it was time for retrieval. And it's not like scientists don't work safely with chemicals like that all the time, but it's still not, you know, ideal, especially with an upload storage speed slower than my spectrum connection. Hence, this latest study from bioengineers at MIT who swapped the silica for polymer chemistry. And yes, amber is a resin, which is a natural polymer, though polymer is a pretty broad category of chemicals that encompasses a range from nylon to DNA itself. In this case, though, the amber to DNA encasement is a reasonable comparison, as our scientists overtly credit amber preservation as their inspiration for their approach, and amber's a glassy polymer, these scientists design a glassy polymer, it's a big category of chemicals, but these two are reasonably alike. I'll allow it. But the synthetic cross-linked polystyrene version does have a few key differences from its tree sap counterpart, namely that this was designed to be easily degraded under controlled conditions, using cysteamine to break the bonds holding the polymer together than a detergent to remove the DNA from the polymer. Overall, that's way easier to work with than hydrofluoric acid. Unlike the silica storage design, it only takes a few hours to thermoset the DNA into the polymer, and our researchers believe they could optimize the process to be faster yet. And because I'm telling you, the moment you let nerds loose on DNA as a data format, you get some dorky stuff. These bioengineers store DNA including the MIT logo, the Emancipation Proclamation, which isn't dorky, that's just really cool, and theme music to Jurassic Park. And just in case you weren't 100% sure that this is a case of self-aware scientific memeing, they called their method Thermoset Reinforced Xeropreservation, or T-Rex. Life scientists find a way. What can I tell you? Once they had stored the DNA in the polymer, they deconstructed it, retrieved the DNA, and sequenced it again to confirm that their process didn't damage the DNA or alter the sequence. So, as a data storage technique, it did what it had to do. But they were so busy thinking about whether they could. Did they stop to think about whether they should? Well, the good news is there's nothing about this that's going to set dinosaurs loose on us. Or maybe that's the bad news, that's up to you. But is this all just a ridiculous gimmick compared to traditional storage media? At the moment, yeah, kinda. This method makes long-term storage of DNA more viable, but it's the synthesis cost more than the storage that's currently bottlenecking me from storing my family photos in .DNA format. Advances like these are critical, though, so that as DNA synthesis does become cheaper over time, the storage side is already in place. And given DNA's stability and the fact that it costs no energy to maintain the data in storage, unlike something like power draw from computer hard drives, it may someday have real advantages, albeit perhaps still real trade-offs, as an archival format. And beyond the big picture, store the world's data in the palm of your hand idea, there are real, practical uses for this technology now. We may not be able to put our Linux ISOs in DNA storage, but we do store DNA for all sorts of reasons, from medical samples to biology research, and it would be incredibly advantageous to be able to store all that at ambient temperature. And this study shows we can do that. It demonstrated protection against heat up to 75 degrees Celsius, or 167 Fahrenheit. Freezers, and the energy needed to power them, aren't a viable solution in many places around the world, and this could become a meaningful alternative to preserve DNA samples in the here and now. Maybe not for tens of millions of years, but long enough for practical medical purposes to meet a need. So no, we still can't do a Jurassic Park. But maybe we can store DNA a little better than those mosquitoes in amber. Maybe someday, someone will spare no expense for our preserved genomes. Maybe someday we can be the raptor we want to see in the world. Rawr.